Hi, I'm Judy Umaki with the League of Women Voters. The League is a nonpartisan organization that has provided voters with unbiased election information since 1920. We've invited candidates to talk with us so you can learn more about them. Joining us now is Patrick Starnes, candidate for governor. Good morning.
Thanks, Judy, for having me.
Thank you for being here.
For the League of Women Voters.
Yeah, we're going to just jump right into things. Tell us why you are running for governor.
Well, I was on school boards. I'd been elected three times over the 10 years of service on school boards. I started to realize how important it was to have somebody in Salem that knew the struggles of school boards on the local level, and those expensive costs of PERS and healthcare, and how those were really taking a lot of money out of the classroom. So I stepped forward as an independent. I felt like as an outsider, I could bring fresh new ideas and solutions to the issues in education.
Good. Well, on that subject of PERS, PERS liability, of course, is going to continue to be a major factor in balancing Oregon's budget. What recommendations of the PERS task force have been implemented, and what more needs to be done? Are there any ideas or proposals on the table that you would support to help us get out of that morass?
Yeah, as you know, I'm the candidate that's capped my donations at $100 per person. I'm the only candidate that's limited, because our main focus is to get big money out of politics. Because in the PERS situation, you have a lot of special interests that keep a stalemate, I would say, on this issue. And one of the solutions that was proposed back in 2013, and to give you a visual of how I feel PERS is, it's like a pyramid that's upside down. We have a lot of baby boomers leaving the system, and we don't have a lot of new young public employees to support the base. So in 2013, they proposed to flip it upside down and add private sector workers, Burger King, gas station workers to PERS that would support that pension system. And so that's what I would support, is a legislation like that. And I call it OURS, ours, because it'd be Oregon Universal Retirement System.
Interesting. Good. Will you champion any changes to our tax system to ensure more stable funding going forward? Like, what are your thoughts about the kicker, for instance?
Yeah, I think the kicker is good for working class folks that need that extra, because at that lower level of income levels, all the money goes into the local economy. Mm-hmm. They're not doing offshore bank accounts and big investments in Asia and stuff like that. So every dollar that a working class person has is spent in the community and circulated in our neighborhoods. So that's so important, that they have as much money as they can have. Mm-hmm. And my big philosophy on taxes and my understanding of tax anger is the general fund is the problem. All the money goes into one big pot, and then they have to divvy it up, and that's where the problems start. And I think that if we had designated money for designated services and have the revenue related to the services, the best example is the gas tax. It goes just for roads. It doesn't go for education, you know, things like that. And so there's less anger, tax anger, about that, and it makes sense. The more you drive, the more you pay, and we could do that with other services that my administration would try to find funds that are related. Like one of my funds is a shelter fund. And when you travel all over Oregon, I've been traveling all over Oregon, you see a lot of vacancies. Mm-hmm. They've been vacant sometimes for 10 years. They call them zombie houses. Mm-hmm. And those vacancies bring down neighborhood values. And so we need I call it a vacancy fine or a vacancy fee that gives those owners incentive to get it back into circulation and back into to house people, so we could have more housing and more services.
Good. Okay. Gun safety is an important but divisive issue in the state and in the nation. Would you support any of the following bills in the Oregon legislature? Ban on certain semi-automatic weapons that use high-capacity magazines, ban on bump stocks, closing the Charleston loophole, safe storage requirements, increased funding for suicide prevention, any of these kind of things?
Yeah, and just like, remember Bloomberg, Michael Bloomberg, the mayor of New York, tried to do the ban on big gulps? Mm-hmm. I'm not in favor so much of banning things. I think they should be taxed, like the soda food tax that goes to healthcare. So for dangerous equipment like semi-automatic weapons, I used to drive a semi, and that's a special license, since it's so much more dangerous that you need to have to do that versus a regular car license. So I think the operators and owners of semi-automatic weapons should have a special license, and that would have a special background check, so that you don't get it in the hands of the mentally ill. And so that's different than registering all the weapons or banning all the weapons, is that you have qualified, well-trained operators that have a special license to own and operate that's dangerous equipment.
Okay, good. Oregon has been a sanctuary state for the last 30 years, which of course means that state and local resources can't be used to enforce federal immigration law if a person's only crime is that they're undocumented or had improper entry. What are your thoughts on the current effort to repeal that sanctuary law?
Originally, when I started this campaign in March, I was sort of neutral about it. I felt like if it was time for Oregon to make that change, that would be fine. But then I learned that most of the incentives for it are from out of the Oregon. And a lot of the large money donations are from out of Oregon. Mm-hmm. And being an advocate of campaign finance reform, this bill should be voted against. And I'll be voting against it. And also, just on a practical level, it's like asking us to Oregon to pay for funding FBI.
Yeah.
You know, and we don't, you know, that's the federal government's job. Just with ICE, that's their job. So, you know, we need to take care of Oregon, and the federal government can take care of immigration.
Okay, good. Do you see any changes to the tax system that would help stabilize the funding? It seems like we're always short, and especially since measures 5 and 50 had a major impact on the amount of money
it's compressed
that
a lot
comes
of,
into the
options.
State.
Yeah. And since income taxes are the majority of our funding, that it's like a one-legged stool, you know, so
is.
We don't have a lot of options. Back to my other point about having different services funded with specific funds, specific revenue that's related to that. At the debate a couple nights ago, I proposed, and I've been proposing this on the campaign, that we have a specific fund for mental health, because mental health affects so many different things. It affects homelessness, it affects the dangerous weapon use that we were just talking about, and we have a lot of vulnerable populations of veterans and disabled folks and seniors. And so we need to have specific funding that's not part of the general fund, and it's not competing with education dollars. And what I propose is, and it's not very popular with the corporate media, is a advertising tax that would go specifically to help mental health. And it would be a designated fund. And it'd be related because, you know, a lot of things that you see in advertisements, especially like glamour magazines, which are half ads, right? This puts a real burden on young women and their issues with their body, you know, anorexia and other issues like that. So in my book, we should, you know, it's like a sin tax, just like junk food tax, that we should have a advertising tax, especially then there's the other pressures from big TV ads on trucks and cars, and you have to have a new one every 3 years, you know. So I don't think we need those kind of mental pressures from advertising, but I don't want to ban them because I believe in free speech. We just should try to collect some revenue that can help us counter our mental health crisis, suicide rates, all that stuff. So that we would have designated money that wouldn't compete with education dollars. And as a matter of fact, education dollars and income are the most related. So to fund education, income tax should fund that. And, you know, and junk food tax should fund healthcare. I'm the only candidate that's a single-payer candidate, and I believe that if we had a junk food tax, we could pay for all of our healthcare. We'd expand OHP, Oregon Health Plan, to every Oregonian. And that's why I call it the grand bargain between single-payer and also the OURS, the hours. Because for employers, especially schools, if we could lower those healthcare costs, we get more dollars into the classroom. To give you a small example, the small school district I was on in McKinsey, it's only 30 employees, but it was $24,000 a month in healthcare costs. So if you're a small business or a small school, that's a half-time person every month. And so we have to get those healthcare costs under control and get the pensioners covered sufficiently. So that's my grand bargain.
Yeah. Interesting. Thanks so much for being here with us.
And thank you. I appreciate your time. Yeah, and thanks for
Take
the
care.
League. Yes. Always asking the good questions.